And we are able and I do need to make this amazing announcement. Yes, we're represented in Staten Island, Bronx, Brooklyn, Queens, and Manhattan. But last night, we launched for the first time the official Not On My Watch, Mount Vernon, New York.
Weird.
band is not on my watch movement. I live with this band every day. Because what's been reported, and I'm going to say reported because everything is not reported, what's been reported is that we lose two children every minute to sex trafficking. So if we're here for 2 hours, we would have lost over 240 children. When you're sitting in those meetings, when you're sitting in, just sitting around and socializing, let's be more conscientious of what's going on outside of these four walls, outside of our houses of worship, outside of our homes and our businesses, and let's be that neighbor that can restore the hood, and let's be that village that can once again raise her children. Can we count on you? Our Not On My Watch Youth Council. We have a Not On My Watch Survivor Leadership Council, which is headed by Cornetta Massilay, which takes in the survivors' voices to influence everything that we do with those that are survivors of domestic violence and sex trafficking and human trafficking, which also includes labor trafficking. But we also formed
you. My sister Frances has a movement because the kind of theme of what I am speaking about today is, where are you pushing the movement? Where are you pushing the movement? And prior to just starting, I want to take the time to just bow our heads and give a quick prayer and acknowledgement of not only how God has allowed us to be here at the front lines, but that we can discern His will and His approach to where we're going to move as a movement moving forward. So, dear Father, we thank you for this great opportunity to join here, our sisters and brothers and neighbors in this space, to really put into action the words that have been said throughout our training, and that we may not only be hearers but doers of the word. That our doing may be accompanied by our understanding that we are shepherds of this movement. And that as human trafficking begins and continues to be known in the highlight and the spotlight, that those that push this movement to a more just, to a more equitable, and to a more focused perspective, understanding that it's not just about human trafficking, but it's about all the causes that lead us to this day, that we may be able to discern your voice among the links of this movement, and that the individuals here today can move forward, highlighting and lifting the humanity of all those that are being trafficked, not just those that are visible to us. We thank you for this awareness, and we thank you for this moment, and in your name we pray.
Amen.
So where are we pushing this movement? That is a question that has been very aware, very vivid in my mind, and in the space that I'm in. Very close. I hope it's not my picture of Facebook Live right up my nose.
Stigma that's also tied
to the issue of poverty. That there are people that are fearful of asking for assistance in an economy that's really pushing us to the brink of whether we can afford to live in the space that we're in. Whether I can pay the formula or the food that my daughter or my children are in need of, and because the government has really shut off its services to me as an individual, I may feel forced to have to traffic and use my body in order to take care of the bodies that I'm responsible for, which are my young children and my young sons and daughters. We see often in our communities that there are criminalizations of our men that force women to have to be not only the caretakers of their families, but not having enough resources because of the criminalization of criminal justice policies force and break up families and allow women not necessarily be present with their young black and brown men that cannot be home because of these poverties. So what is happening is we're seeing this confluence of events that are pushing many of our young people that we see in D.C., but have not received the necessary attention of where are the missing girls in our inner cities and in our spaces that are not receiving the media attention because they are usually being invisible by the people that are trying to raise awareness on human trafficking. But this issue of human trafficking is not limited to the plight of our sisters here in the United States. We're seeing how the issue of the refugee crisis. And it is interesting that many of the people that are raising the alarm of human trafficking down in Washington are those that are closing the doors of our country to those that are becoming more vulnerable, especially our refugee children, where I learned right now that over 91,000 individuals that are becoming refugees are unaccompanied minors. Unaccompanied children under the ages of 14 that have no one to take care of them, that are in these countries fleeing war and persecution, and that just last year, 10,000 of those young children that are unaccompanied have gone unaccounted for. Where do you think those young people are turning to? They are turning to this growing network of human trafficking that has taken away our young children that are different from us, maybe because they're not citizens of their country, but in our goal of trying to elevate the issue of human trafficking in our other places of the country that are closing the doors to our brown sisters and brothers in other countries that cannot have access to the policies that are here. And this is what is frustrating to me, because it is the stigmatizing of individuals that are less powerless throughout the world that are also contributing to the church not necessarily taking a stand to be able to deconstruct that stigma that is hurting the people that are considered to be on the lower end of the hierarchy of lives here in our society. Whether these are individuals that are black or brown, that are kind of at the intersection of being oppressed by bad criminal justice policies, by bad funding for services at the local level, by wanting to wash away this issue as an issue that's only tied to those that are humanity making more visible in our spaces. But I find comfort in the scriptures, because the scriptures tell us that we cannot separate the humanity of people in order to serve them, but in fact that we all, whether we're here in the Bronx trying to spur this movement, whether we're somewhere in Westchester County or in any state in New Jersey or in the South States, but whether we are individuals that are in other countries that are not allowing entrance into this space, all people have humanities that we are not acknowledging. We all have strands of divinity in ourselves, and I find Ecclesiastes 3:11 as a centerpiece of what God's mind is, to not only be a hearer, but a doer of the word in this faith. That teaches me that I have to put this movement, the direction of this movement. I just thought I'd heard that now on my watch is now a movement that is international, that is seeking not only to spur this conversation in different cities, but is now trying to have this conversation spoken throughout this country and throughout our globe. Because what we're seeing is that if we are trying to take this message throughout the world, we must have an analysis that is focused on the least of these and elevating their humanity. And I find this in Ecclesiastes 3:11 that states that the Creator of all people, that God, has made everything beautiful in its time. And I just want to pause there very quickly. Because one of the issues that we see that becomes a catalyst for human trafficking are individuals that have identified their worth to be lesser than what God has stated their worth is. We have seen people that, because of the stigma that are often present in our spaces of worship, that says, you are not holy enough, you are not good enough, you are not pure enough if you fall into what we call are the bad sins in the church, even though I thought that God makes no exception of people and that all sins are unique in His sight. But we try to name individuals that are suffering through depression, that are suffering through neglect, that are suffering through domestic violence, that are suffering through the stigma that is tied to those that have been sexually abused in our houses of worship. That is a topic we most likely not like to talk about in our spaces, but we continue to leave these issues closeted up, and we demonize those that are in those spaces. And I think an issue that we need to talk about in our communities is how we continue to demonize our sisters and our brothers, because now we're seeing in the LGBTQ community, many of them that worship in our services, but are not free to stand up, because we know that we will cast them out on the streets and become the homeless sons and daughters that become victims of human trafficking. We fail to humanize them and we label them as sinners that are not worthy. As sinners that are not worthy of humanizing and acknowledging of love. And then what happens is that when we push them outside of these spaces, we are pushing a movement that is not healing those that are in need of sustenance. $8 billion in Medicaid that is going to be cut. Do you know that those are the services They can't pay their food. They don't have food that is on the table anymore. And what the other side of human trafficking usually says, let's leave our churches in power to be able to serve the communities. Not only that, oftentimes the churches are able to serve as empowers of people by making sure that they're enrolled in service that maximize their value, that they're receiving benefits that can prevent them from slipping into poverty and homelessness. But when we don't view these issues interconnected, we get very distracted about language of, let's start addressing human trafficking, but let's close those doors to our poor that are looking for opportunities to not be human trafficking in the countries that are trying to come here. We cannot disconnect ourselves from the humanity of others because God, as Scripture stated, made everything beautiful in its time. The beauty that I see in you, the beauty that I see in my sister or my brother or someone that identifies as another identity who needs, I'm telling you, an issue that people have failed to realize is that the highest rates of vulnerability now are found in our sisters and brothers that are leaving the church and they don't receive support because they may identify as a different type of identity, and those are the people that are being used to be trafficking in our urban centers. We need to start thinking in a more broad, intersectional, and way of acknowledging the human dignity of every single human being. And then God states, right after the Ecclesiastes 3:11, God has made everything beautiful in his time. God then goes on to say, after that first part, God has deposited eternity upon the hearts of all people. There is infinite, unmeasurable value inside of all ourselves. But when we push this movement to be siloed, when we push this movement in ways that not seek solidarity with other groups that we may be not necessarily comfortable with, what we do is fail to move the dream that Dr. King had when he moved from just civil rights to economic rights, which is actually what led to the death of him when he started speaking about the real oppression that was existing upon us. And I'm telling you, the next 2 or 3 months, these systems are going to be deconstructed, and people are going to try to put people into boxes saying, you know what, the humanity of people that are close to you is more important than the humanity of those that are far. When we call ourselves to be ambassadors of a kingdom that knows no limits or bounds, we need to expand our vision by acknowledging that we set eternity upon the hearts of all people. But then what happens is that at the end of that verse is where people need to get tripped up, and it's another part of the human experience, especially as sons and daughters of the Lord. The verse says, God has made everything beautiful in his time, set eternity upon the hearts of all people, but people do not know the work of God who made it. And it is interesting because Ecclesiastes 3:11 is famous for a verse that talks, starting about that there is a time for everything. There is a time to build movements, and there is a time to tear down. There is a time to be born, and there's a time to die. There is a time to knit together, and there's a time to tear apart. But when then God, after that, says there is everything is beautiful in its time, we must see how other human beings express themselves, and then start an analysis not based on stigmatizing them, but understanding why is it that they choose to represent themselves to be like this in the first place. That oftentimes, or most of the times, We're saying we know how to discern the will of God, but we do not know the word of God from beginning to end. And what happens is that when we don't engage with other folk, and we won't take an analysis that considers all of the different issues that are affecting and that are causes of poverty and of stigma that pushes the youth to drive me, then we get happy when government gives us crumbs that have distracted us from the big issue, is that we continue to not elevate the humanity of all individuals. And what this then results as us focusing on just the symptoms and not the causes. And my fear that becomes is that's where we push the movement. We push the movement that looks at symptoms and not causes. Because we are not understanding that the healthcare crisis, that the upcoming budgetary cuts that are coming, that are going to cut services for people to drop into poverty, those are things that are going to expand the numbers of those that will be vulnerable to trafficking. So what is it that we do then? What are we called to become in this space, in this moment, in this time? And it is not only hearers, but doers of what we learn. That when we are able to do together, when we're able to understand that the Apostle Paul says that once we've done that transformation, there's neither Jew or Gentile. There is neither rich nor poor. There is an acknowledgement that we must have our analysis focused on lifting the humanity of those that are most vulnerable around us. And that this specific group that has acknowledged that too many of our black and brown children, as we've seen in D.C., are being targeted, and that we cannot allow ourselves as a city to not have an army of faith institutions that are equipped to elevate the humanity of all folks, not allow them to become stigmatized, but be able to connect them to services and resources that elevate their lives. I think that we're becoming a city and a movement that is pushing in the right direction. And that's why I commend all of you all today for taking a step. I commend you for acknowledging that we cannot turn a blind eye and not allow those that have a narrative that is exclusionary, that wants to use this movement as a prop to justify the cutting of mercy to our refugees, sisters and brothers from other countries, that want to cut care for the most vulnerable in our society, and that want to then put the burden on the shoulders of faith communities that are not even equipped or resource sufficient to deal with this issue. We can call that what that is. That is a pairing, that is an exclusionary issue that is coming out of Washington. And we, as a city, must understand that all these issues intersect, and that we must stand to make sure that we do not put more pressure on our vulnerable sisters, brothers, and people of other identities that are finding themselves trafficked and vulnerable in this situation. So, I encourage you to push the movement by becoming doers and not becoming just hearers, and that you push towards a direction that doesn't stigmatize, that you push in a direction that elevates the humanity of all people, no matter how distinct or maybe unlike our experiences are in society. So I want to thank you and I congratulate you. And also, just want to acknowledge to our Borough President, Gail Brewer, who's entering this place. Our Borough President, Gail, has been there for communities of faith, fighting for equity and justice, but also serving as a leader in spaces where oftentimes we need to be leadership in. So I just want to thank her for honoring all of us who are present for that and Reverend Huey Bishop Timothy. Thank you for being the panelist. health care. Monday, we're going to be at Bronx Christian Fellowship at 6 o'clock. And I encourage everybody to be there, where we're going to have the Children's Defense Fund speaking about how we can advocate against these cuts that are coming down here in Washington. So, that's why I wanted to talk about the intersectional nature of all of our issues. And I encourage us to be there Sunday, 6 p.m. Everybody knows where BCF is at? Bronx Christian Fellowship? We'll make sure the information is out there. But please, let's continue this fight, and I want to thank